soon enough had a nickname.
Soul Patrol was a name.
Go to the restroom, open the window, climb out, don't be there.
He loved the Oakland Raiders because of they gave him a final shot. They treated him like a man. They let him run.
You weren't there because you were a Boy Scout. You weren't there on Sunday afternoon because you cut your hair. You were there on Sunday afternoon because you're the best player the Raiders could find at that point in time to put out in the field.
Everybody goes to Oakland, but you can get anything you want in this town, anything. You know, it's always there. And they let you breathe here. You know, they let you breathe.
Base hit by Campanera.
By the fall of 72, both of the city's teams were seen as scruffy outsiders. And as the Oakland A's rolled to their first World Series, another Finley gimmick caught on. He offered his players extra cash if they would grow mustaches. The press gave the A's a new nickname, the Mustache Gang. And for Raleigh Fingers, who rescued a failing career by going to the bullpen, his handlebar became his calling card.
$300, that's a week's salary. So, you know, guys would grow a mustache on just about any part of their body for $300.
This was in the 70s, and hair was, you know, you dictated where you stood in the political and sociological spectrum. And so essentially it was like a bunch of hippies were playing baseball.
Only in Oakland, man. Beards, mustaches, no other team had that. Shoot, the Yankees had to almost be like Marines to play ball. These guys had, you know, I mean, what a team. Think about it.
Rudy not running, base hit, put the extra bases to left center field. Here comes Jackson, diving to the third base, and he makes it.
The corner's on him, and he is good.
The A's entered the World Series as decided underdogs to Cincinnati and its big red machine. It was the hares versus the squares.
Everybody thought the big red machine was just going to walk all over us.
There was no chance for the A's, and they would get swept, and that would be that, but it would be a good run. We got there at least.
I think we were as surprised as anybody when we took the first two games and we're heading back to Oakland with a 2-0 lead. I mean, it really just, you know, hey, maybe we are this good.
The World Series went 7 games, with 6 of them decided by one run. The tightest series in nearly 50 years. At last, Oakland had its first baseball championship. And perhaps more importantly, it had something San Francisco didn't.
Anytime you live in the shadow of cosmopolitan San Francisco and you can get one up on them, you're happy, you know? And when the A's were whipping everybody's butt, man, you know, it was a happy town.
It was status for the first time. It's like, lo and behold, Oakland is mainstream now somehow. We're not just, you know, Bakersfield West. We're bigger than that.
I remember the A's won the World Series, and they asked me if they could parade the A's donkey around the field before the game. And I exploded. I went nuts. There's no way. We don't give a damn about the A's or their donkey or Charlie Finley. And, you know, I mean, we did. You know, we were proud of him. We're proud, you know, to be from Oakland. But at that time, we weren't going to let, you know, the donkey parade around the doggone field before a football game.
Madden and the Raiders were all business and in the hunt for the city's second title of 1972. In December, they faced the Pittsburgh Steelers in the AFC divisional playoff. With less than 2 minutes to play in the game, the Raiders trailed 6-0.
Ken Stabler, on those glass knees of his, had just literally dove head first, you know, across the goal line to go ahead 7-6. And there was no time left. I thought, my God, the clouds have parted. All those pass interference calls, you know, that had gone against the Raider defense says now, that's karma. We've earned a spot now.
With only 22 seconds left in the game, Pittsburgh faced a desperation 4th-and-10 from their own 40.
It was the last play of the game. So we're talking about finality. I mean, once it's over, there's no, well, we'll get them next week.
Last chance for the Steelers. Bradshaw trying to get away. And his pass is broken up by Tatum.
when you see it now and you look back at the slow motion, it looked like it took forever. It didn't. It was so quick.
And his pass is broken up by Tatum.
I was covering Franco Harris on the play. Franco, I think they called for him to block. Terry Bradshaw gets flushed out of the pocket. Franco just starts jogging downfield. Jack Tatum, all he had to do was just knock the ball down. The game's over with. He drills him in the back. The ball bounces off Fuqua's shoulder. I'm running there. The ball goes right straight over my head. I turn, and there's Mr. Jogger going down the field over there. And here it comes. And I said, no!
In those days, you couldn't have a double touch. You know, that if the ball hit Frenchie Fuqua, then it would be illegal for Franco Harris to catch it.
I just remember being in the room, and my cousin said, they're going to screw us. You know it's an incomplete pass, and you know they're not going to call it an incomplete pass because the people in Pittsburgh will burn down the stadium.
So I ran on the field, and the officials were huddling there. And they said, get off the field. We don't know what happened. I said, I know you don't know what happened. I'm going to tell you what happened. And they said, get off.
One of the officials at the end of that play called security. And he said, you know, how many guys you got on here today? And they said, oh, we're a little short-handed. So he said, well, in that case, that baby's a touchdown.
The Immaculate Reception was, for me as a sports fan, the worst moment of my life. We went to Pittsburgh. And we beat them, and they took it away.
In other words, we got shafted. We just had this feeling that the league was always watching us a little bit closer than the other teams. I actually thought that the NFL had a vendetta against the Oakland Raiders.
Everybody's fan of the Oakland Raiders knows where they were when John F. Kennedy was shot, and they know what they were doing and where they were, what house they were sitting in when Franco Harris caught the Immaculate Reception there in Pittsburgh.
After the Immaculate Reception, the Watergate burglars went on trial, marking the beginning of the end of a presidency.
Because people have got to know whether or not their president's a crook. Well, I'm not a crook.
Later the same month, the Paris Peace Accords were signed, marking the beginning of the end of the Vietnam War. For Bay Area leaders of the peace movement, it was an enormously important moment.
In many ways, the best parts of the 60s took place. Beginning in January 73, because there was not just the bonding of all the people who were united against injustice and war and oppression and all of those things. There was also a great sense of celebration.
There was, you know, a real sense that, hey, we, by bitching and complaining and getting in the way of things, we thought we were accomplishing. You know, we were changing society.
The A's also should have been celebrating in the wake of their series triumph, but Finley's team was too busy fighting. The world champions were one of the lowest paid teams in professional baseball.
He tried to get by as cheap as he could, and that was the way Charlie Finley was. You know, after the 72 World Series, I'm making $29,000. If he'd have said, here, Raleigh, here's $15,000 raise, you did a great job, I'd have signed it in a heartbeat. But to send you a $1,000 raise and kind of slap you in the face, that just turned me completely off to Charlie Finley, and it turned off everybody off.
One common goal we had was to prove to him that we were worth of the money that we were making.
My job was easier, because usually there'll be some disgruntled guy that doesn't like the manager. But I was just like one of the players because they all hated Charlie.
In a self-conscious city itching for respect, it bothered Oakland that Finley was an absentee owner. The citizenry appreciated that Al Davis lived in Oakland, while Finley operated out of his office in Chicago or his farm in Indiana.
There was no connect between Finley and the community, in part because he lived in Illinois or Indiana, wherever the hell he lived. Who cares?
Incredibly, Finley chose a child to be his eyes and ears back in Oakland.
Hell, our chief executive, the guy that ran our team, that communicated to Charlie Finley, who was the top man there, was a 13-year-old kid. I nicknamed him Hammer. because he looked like Hank Aaron. MC Hammer.
Charlie said, I'm getting you a new hat. I don't want you to have a hat that says A's on it. I'm getting you a hat that says EXVP. That's Executive Vice President. You're running the joint around here.
He also was an informant, a clubhouse informant for Charlie. And he got the nickname Pipeline.
Every time I come down to the clubhouse, Raleigh would yell out, oh, everybody be quiet. Here comes Pipeline.
Charlie got a kick out of it. So one day he called me before the game and he said, I want to tell you that you've got a new broadcast partner today. He said, Hammer's going to come over and do an inning. I said, a play-by-play you're talking about? He said, yeah, play-by-play. He's been doing it for me every day on the phone. He can do it.
Welcome to Station WCOF. It's me, the Lil Hammer. Lovely Oakland Coliseum. Fighters on the mound. Looks in. Kicks and throws. Long outside. Ball one.
And the phone rang in my boots, and I figured, well, Charlie, here's Charlie telling me how great he is. Well, it wasn't. It was the general manager of KNBR, Bill Dwyer, and he said, what in the world's going on there? Get that kid off the air.
Wherever he was, Finley was a constant meddler in Oakland, a control freak addicted to the telephone.
One time I went down to the dugout to get a drink, and the phone rang, and I picked up the phone and said, hello, Charlie. And the other guy in the voice said, who's this? I said, this is Fingers. He says, well, this is Charlie. Don't you ever pick up the phone again like that. I said, here's Dick.
As soon as that game was over and we had to go up those stairs up to the clubhouse, my phone was ringing. Say we won 4-2, I'd expect, you know, a nice going, Dick, good game. He'd say, well, if you did this in the third inning, you'd have won 6-2.
Sparked by their hatred for Finley, the A's dominated baseball in 1973. They won their division by 6 games and returned to the World Series to face the New York Mets.
Heading forth and playing center field, number 9, Reggie Jackson.
But somehow, the egomaniacal Finley took the spotlight from his players. In the second game of the series, the A's second baseman Mike Andrews made 2 errors in an extra inning loss. After the game, Finley kicked him off the team.
This is the crappiest thing he's ever done. Here it is, right in front of your faces. Well, then you are the asshole we all thought you were. And here's the proof that everybody else in America can see.
It's such a black eye on what happened. But that team responded by going the next day in New York to practice at Shea Stadium with the Mike Andrews number on armbands around their arm.
The commissioner stepped in and forced him to bring Andrews back. And I use them the first chance I get. Got a tremendous ovation. Everybody sitting up at Shea Stadium, I think, except Charlie.
They got him. They got him.
Poor little Mike Andrews. It's a scapegoat. We thought it was a case of Finley, a bully, picking on somebody who couldn't fight back. And to see Mike Andrews be reinstated at that time, we just thought, got it, Finley got what he deserves.
All the while, the A's were locked in another tight World Series. For the 7th game, Reggie Jackson led the team onto the field.
We went out, and Matlack was pitching, lefty, tough. You know, we got him. He messed around, hung me a breaking ball, and I dropped a souvenir on him. Yeah, had a good day. Took the trophy home. We won. Yeah, took home the gold.
Back-to-back championships. No team had done that since the Mantle Maris Yankees of a decade earlier.
Thank you.
And again, thanks again for an outstanding performance, not only during the year, but the World Series.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Hey, Reggie, you said you were going to go home yesterday.
But Finley's outrageous behavior tarnished the title.
Oh, mad at Charlie. He shouldn't have kicked up his heels and wanted to be the whole show right in the middle of a beautiful World Series. Those boys were working their guts out for him.
Maybe some of you might like to see me sell it, but the team is not for sale.
Charlie O drove more of a wedge between himself and his players by handing out championship rings that were made with cheap imitation stones. Catfish Hunter angrily called them horse meat.
Charlie's got his name all over this ring, but he also has an inscription, a motto that he stood by, S plus S equals S, which is sweat plus sacrifice equals success. Now, we all thought it meant shit plus shit equals more shit.